So in other words, the Prophet ﷺ clarified this revelation that he received from Allah Azza wa Jalla to such a degree there's nothing left. That's why Allah tells us in Surah Al-Ma'idah that He has completed this deen. أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ I have completed for you your deen. وَأَتْمَمْتُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي And I have perfected my blessings upon you. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا And I have chosen for you, or I am pleased for you, Islam as your religion. Now, the Sahaba understood this. In the farewell pilgrimage, the Prophet ﷺ, he asked the people there, did I not convey the message, right? And they said, yes. And he says, Allahumma ashhad. Oh Allah, bear witness that they have said, I have conveyed to them the message. They have no doubts as to what this religion is about. And likewise, we find Abu Dharr, for instance, saying that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, and there is not a single bird in the heavens above flapping its wings, except that he has taught us some knowledge regarding that. So it doesn't mean that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was teaching them the intricacies of biology or animals and so on. But it's a similitude. That if you're just to imagine a bird flapping its wings, the Prophet even taught us about that. There's nothing except that he's given us some knowledge regarding it. And concerning the birds, the Prophet did teach us some things about them, right? He tells us in the Hadith of the Tirmidhi, right, that if you were to rely upon Allah, حَقَّ تُوَكُّلِهِ rely and trust in Allah as He deserves, right? He would give you your sustenance like the birds. They leave their nest in the early morning with their bellies empty, and they return with their bellies full. So even the birds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet gave us some knowledge regarding their activities. That they have tawakkul upon Allah. Now, so the companions, they understood this. And as a result, the companions, in a practical way of learning the Qur'an, they approached the Qur'an in a way which allowed them not just to learn its words, but learn its meanings. Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, who's from the Tabi'een. The Tabi'un are the second generation. They're the ones who didn't meet the Prophet ﷺ, but they met the Prophet's companions. So Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, he said that those who used to teach us the Qur'an, like Uthman bin Affan and Abdullah bin Mas'ud. Uthman bin Affan, of course, is a great companion of the Prophet ﷺ. He is the one who, by his command, that the copies of the Mus'haf were made and distributed throughout the Islamic world, and the script that we use for writing the Qur'an is referred to as the Uthmani script, and we call this the Mus'haf al-Uthmani, in reference to Uthman ibn Affan. And also Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who I spoke about last night, was one of the Prophet's leading companions, who took 70 surahs from the mouth of the Prophet ﷺ himself. So Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami is saying that those who used to teach us the Qur'an, like Uthman ibn Affan and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and others, that if they used to learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 10 ayat, they would not exceed that until they learned all which was incorporated or in those ayat from knowledge and action. Okay? So here he's explaining how they used to learn the Quran. They would take 10 ayat from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would not try to memorize another 10 ayat until they had learned from the Quran those 10 ayat. They understood what it incorporated from knowledge and action. And so they used to say, we learnt the Qur'an and knowledge and action at the same time. فَتَعَلَّمْنَا الْقُرْآنَ وَالْعِلْمَ وَالْعَمَلْ جَمِيعًا We learnt the Qur'an, in other words, we learnt its memorization of its wording, and knowledge and action at the same time. For this reason we find Abdullah bin Umar, who was one of the youth of the Umar's son Abdullah, and also a scholar when he grew up to be a man, one of the youth of the Prophet's companions. It took him 8 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. 8 years. Now, why did it take him 8 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah? It's not because he was a slower memory or he was a weak student. It took him 8 years because they were following this type of methodology for learning the Qur'an. They would take 10 ayat, memorize it, and also learn what incorporated of knowledge and of meaning. And so that's why they used to say that if they used to find somebody who had memorized Surah Al-Baqarah or Surah Al-Imran, they used to think this was a scholar indeed. Because for them, to memorize these surahs was not just to memorize its wording, but also to know what all it incorporates from knowledge and action. So if you knew Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran, I mean, you must have spent at least 15 years or 16 years studying. If it takes you 8 years for Surah Al-Baqarah, Al-Imran is a little bit shorter, so we'll say 7. So it takes you 15 years, let's say, to put it together. So this is, I mean, obviously shows your scholarship. Now, we also can understand this if we look at the matter from an argument of reason. In other words, if we look at the issue of the Qur'an, by reason itself, we should expect that the Prophet's companions try to learn also its meanings and not just its wording. They also try to learn its meanings and not its wording. Why? Because if we look at human beings, you know, whenever human beings have something of importance to them, they not only will commit it to memory, but they will also are more eager also to, more than to memorize it, they are also eager to understand it. Okay? I remember one of the first things they taught us to memorize when we were boys in school, in primary school, was the Constitution, the preamble of the Constitution of the United States, we the people in order to more form a more perfect union, and so forth and so on. And this was the first thing because, I mean, for the Americans, this is their, you know, I mean, important document. Okay. And likewise, when you go through your school, your studies, whenever there's a textbook of importance, it's the practice that people explain the textbook. You know, you have your professor come and he'll explain passages and he'll go over it and he'll talk about it and you'll have discussions and so forth because this is something where your studies are going to go, especially with law books. And we know, for instance, the Quran has a lot of legal, not just legal laws, but also has a lot of legal principles and legal maxims and so forth. So this is something which we should expect. Likewise, we find that in the Quran itself, it condemns not paying attention to its meaning. I mean, the Quran itself condemns those people who do not try to contemplate its meanings. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says concerning the unbelievers, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Do they not try to contemplate and ponder over the Quran? Or is it that there are locks upon their heart? In other words, the reason why they can't ponder it is because their hearts have been sealed by Allah Azza wa Jalla, and so therefore the meanings of the Quran cannot penetrate their hearts and their minds and their souls. And the Quran has been selected to be in the Arabic language for the purpose of it to be understood and to be thought about and to be contemplated and to be pondered over. إِنَّ أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. We have sent down it as an Arabic Quran so that perhaps you, the address is primarily to the people of Arabia at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, but it's generic to all human beings at all times, because the Quran, by its definition, is a book for all of humanity until the end of time. Why have we sent it down as an Arabic Quran? لَعَلَّكُمْ, that perhaps you may reason, you may think, you may contemplate. And it is said that the Arabic language is such that it allows for this type of deep contemplation, the structure of the Arabic language and its form. And that's one of the reasons why Allah chose the Arabic language as a vehicle for His final revelation. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns the unbelievers for not contemplating or understanding the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَالِ هَوْلَاءِ الْقَوْمِ. What is it with these people? لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ حَدِيثًا. That they can't even understand a single sentence. And what's wrong with them? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns the hypocrites by saying, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَسْتَمِعُ إِلَيْكَ. Amongst them, amongst the hypocrites, are those who listen to you. حَتَّى إِذَا خَرَجُوا مِنْ عِنْدِكَ. Until when they leave your presence, قَالُوا لِلَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ مَاذَا قَالَ آنِفًا. They are with you, listening to you, and then when they leave your presence, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they say to the knowledgeable ones among the Prophet's companions, what did he just say? So in other words, they were sitting there listening to the Prophet ﷺ, but they did not comprehend what he was saying. And so Allah is condemning them. So the Sahaba understood this. And Allah here in this last verse, I mentioned, that he showed that there was people who utul ilm, who were given knowledge. So they could answer the hypocrites by saying what the Prophet ﷺ was teaching, explaining it to them. And they applied this methodology. And likewise, they transmitted this methodology to the second generation. This way of approaching the Quran. We find among Ibn Abbas's students, a great scholar by the name of Mujahid, who says, I presented the Mus'haf to Ibn Abbas three times, beginning from its beginning to its end, stopping him at each ayah and asking him regarding it. So here, I mean, here this is just shows, I mean, Mujahid's zealousness to learn the Quran. He's taking the Mus'haf, and for three times, not just once, but times, each ayah, he stops at the ayah and he asks Ibn Abbas, what does this mean? What is this referring to? Concerning whom was it revealed? What was the context of this ayah? So, for this reason, they, the Tabi'een also took it. And that's why you find a person from the third generation, Sufyan al-Thawri, said, if tafsir comes to you from Mujahid, suffice, that's enough for you. Because Mujahid's great concern to learn the meanings of the Quran from the companion of the Prophet ﷺ, Ibn Abbas. Now, another thing which distinguished the companions in understanding the Quran was the fact that they actually witnessed the revelation. In other words, the Quran was revealed in you might say, in two modes. Sometimes it was revealed in Allah would initiate a revelation concerning something. Other times it was revealed due to an incident that occurred. An incident would occur, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send down some guidance regarding that incident. For instance, important issue is the Battle of Badr. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala initiated some ayat regarding the Battle of Badr to an incident that occurred.